You are about to listen to the Dr. Daliah Show. Sassy, stimulating medical talk radio. Any medical advice Dr. Daliah Wax gives on her show should not be substituted for an actual visit to your medical provider. And now, here's Dr. Daliah.
Doctor, doctor, give me the news. I got a bad case of loving you.
All right, we are back on the Dr. Daliah Show. 1-877-DOCDALIAH. 1-877-DOCDALIAH. So, you know, we think of the classic heart attack symptoms, chest pain, difficulty breathing, passing out for heart disease. But what we don't educate people on are the subtle signs of heart disease. And what has always baffled me is whenever I did diagnose a heart attack in the ER or take care of a person with heart disease, I asked them, you know, did you ever have chest pain? Did you have trouble breathing? And many of them said they did, and they had ignored it. They didn't realize that that could be something serious. They thought they pulled a muscle. But there were also a lot of subtle signs that years prior. And because nobody's talking about these subtle signs, people aren't getting taken care of until it's too late, or they never get taken care of because they just get their sudden heart attack. So, I mean, one example of one of these subtle signs is what I noticed with my father. So my father was sitting there watching TV, and I went to tie my shoe, and I noticed his ankles had no hair. And I'm thinking to myself, okay, my father has less hair on his legs than I do. And I was, I had told him, I want you to check your heart. He was stubborn. He never did. He ended up dying of a heart attack later that year. Now, I'm not saying just because you have clean shaven looking legs, you have heart disease. But men, women, if you're noticing you don't have that much hair, women, if you're noticing you shave less these days, you got to make sure that's not a sign of heart disease. Men, you should have hair just like you always have on your legs. If that hair starts to go away, that could be a sign, maybe not even of heart disease, but of peripheral vascular disease where you have artery clogging. I'm telling you right now, if you have artery clogging or loss of blood flow to the legs that's generating good skin and good hair, there's a good chance it's affecting the heart. Another subtle sign that you could have heart disease or clogged arteries is you need Viagra. We spoke about this. If you need erectile dysfunction medication, before you even take it, you have got to get your heart checked. Because if you're having poor blood flow to the penis, there's a very good chance you also have poor blood flow to the brain and to the heart. If you cut yourself and you notice it takes forever to heal, whereas you used to heal a lot quicker before, and we're talking it just doesn't heal, and you always need to call in for antibiotics or you need wound care, there's a chance that you have artery clogging or you don't have the healthiest of vessels. Now, peripheral vascular disease is in and of itself a whole nother beast, where you have artery clogging or you have insufficiency of your veins or arteries and it affects blood flow. But it's very rare to just have that separately without there being other concomitant issues that could be affecting heart, brain, etc. So these are some little signs. If you notice that when you go upstairs, you're a little more winded than you used to, and you're like, I used to do these stairs without a problem before, that could be a sign of heart disease. If you get nauseous more than you used to, just randomly, you didn't eat a burrito, you didn't eat some old chicken, you didn't drink, and all of a sudden you're getting waves of nausea, that could be a sign of heart disease. And I don't want to scare you all. I don't want everybody thinking, oh gosh, I'm about ready to have a heart attack. But I want you guys to be thinking about not ignoring these other symptoms. I told you when I was an ER doc, there was somebody who came in with major tooth pain. And they're like, I don't know what's wrong. And I look at that tooth and I like, I don't see what's wrong. I don't see anything going on in the gums. And all they had was tooth pain. I'm like, for poops and giggles, let me check your heart. Turned out he had a heart attack the night before. There is these signs might not be the typical. The typical signs are chest pain, like an elephant sitting on your chest, chest pressure, difficulty breathing, sweats, severe nausea, severe dizziness, severe fatigue. But subtler signs are my tooth hurts. I had that one woman that came in thinking she had a bladder infection. She said, I have a UTI. Well, she had some inflammatory cells in the urine. But later, she had nausea while she was in the ER. When we gave her nausea medicine, she starts having shortness of breath. It ended up she had a heart attack the night before in her sleep. When she woke up, she just felt awful. So she thought it was a UTI. See, the other thing, too, is we humans get biased. When we have a medical condition and we feel similar to when we had that medical condition, we think it's that medical condition. So you're having burning when you pee. You think it's a UTI. Well, it could be an STI, a sexually transmitted illness, or STD. It could be a gynecological issue. It could be a prostate issue. You know, we bias ourselves. Nausea. How many times have we had nausea from a stomach flu or a stomach bug? If you're having nausea, right, and you're not having the diarrhea, nobody else is sick around you, you got to get that checked out. Abdominal pain could be a heart attack. People forget that. Your right shoulder, right side of the body could still be hurt. Everybody says, well, it's just my left. It's my left arm. My left arm was tingling, left chest pain, left-sided shoulder pain. Okay, more commonly left. But I had a patient come in where their pain was on the right. It could happen. I mean, when you're having that chest pressure and it's center, you might not feel it as much. What if you've had surgery so you have fewer nerves and you're feeling less on the left? What if you had a mini stroke, so you're feeling less on the left? Your right side might be the only thing telling you that something's wrong. Shoulder pain, neck pain could be a sign of heart disease. Clogged arteries. Memory loss. Issues with your vision. Issues with your hearing. I don't want to scare you all, but for those of you saying, you know, my hearing isn't the same. Now, I get one-sided headaches. My memory's off. For the love of the Lord, please get your arteries checked. It's very easy. They could do an ultrasound of your neck. They could ultrasound your heart. They could do a stress test. There's lots of things they could do these days. But get yourself checked out. 1-877-DOC-DOLLY. Don't go away.
Let's see, if something costs less, but people are happier with it, that sounds like something to look into, and that's MediShare. Maybe you've heard switching to MediShare to pay for healthcare can save the typical family $500 a month, and that's huge, but it's also true that people are way more satisfied after making the switch, too. The customer satisfaction rate for MediShare is double that of the typical health insurance plan, double. MediShare works. It's been around for more than a quarter century, and members have shared more than $3 billion of each other's bills. People love having telehealth and a huge nationwide PPO network. So, yeah, you can save a ton and like it better. Imagine being happy with how you're taking care of your health care. So if you're self-employed or part of the gig economy, or you just want a plan you're happy with, you can call right now and get a price within 2 minutes. A very, very smart use of 2 minutes. Here's the number you need. 855-SHARE-40. That's 855-SHARE-40. 855-SHARE-40.
Hey guys, it's Dr. Daliah. Fantasy football season is coming, but sadly, too many of you are taking the bench while the country takes part in one of the most exciting and lucrative industries out there. Don't know how to play? Well, huddle up and listen. Paul Kalikas and I have written a fantasy football pocket guide for beginners. This book walks you through the basics and shows you how simple and lucrative joining or creating a fantasy football team can be. Read our Fantasy Football Pocket Guide for Beginners found on Amazon or follow the links on X and Facebook. That's Fantasy Football Pocket Guides for Beginners. Don't be left out.
In a study, it was found that 33% of 44 herbal supplements had no trace of the advertised herb. Don't let that happen to you. Hi, this is Dr. Mitch. If you want to ensure quality, please go to TotalWellness.com. Supplements made for physicians only now available to you too. TotalWellness.com, helping you to look good, feel good, and enjoy total wellness.
are back on the Dr. Daliah Show. Thank you all for tuning in. 1-877-DOC-DALIH, 1-877-DOCDALI. Big thanks to Talk Media Network for making the show happen, and big thanks to Daniel, our producer. So this is pretty interesting. I remember that Ashley Madison website. This was fascinating to me, and I don't know why anybody would go on it, but apparently there was a huge demand for infidelity. And Ashley Madison was a site that I guess was established online in 2001. And, you know, this is when, you know, internet was already taking hold and getting more popular, and it was before Facebook and other things. And maybe MySpace was around. But Ashley Madison had this slogan, life is short, have an affair. And so 37 million people, or technically unfaithful individuals, decided to create profiles to link up and cheat on their partners. And it was supposed to be discreet. I don't understand how people would trust a computer, because it ends up getting hacked. And in 2015, all the data got leaked. So there were many individuals, including celebrities, who now were outed as being cheaters. Now, according to the Daily Mail, the group who claimed responsibility for the hack was called the Impact Team. And they, I guess they didn't like some of the site's features. They demanded that the site be taken down. And when it wasn't, they decided to release all of the 37 million records for everybody to see. They said the trove of data purporting to belong to the users was shared on the dark web. Police, Ashley Madison executives scrambled to try to find who this Impact Team was. No arrests were ever made. And still, people wonder who hacked Ashley Madison, the site. Now they say that there's a new Netflix docuseries entitled Ashley Madison, Sex, Lies, and Scandal. And it talks about how what happened when people were exposed. And apparently some of the individuals who were on there, I don't really care. I'm not here to talk about who cheated and who didn't. I mean, I could understand how people in the media could be very interested in what these sites are, so they set up an account. But once you start to, I guess, I don't know what the older tech looked like, but my guess is it was very similar to Facebook or Instagram, where you could instant message or direct message and then talk. And then within that text thread or that communication thread, establish hookups, etc. And when I look at this story, I think about the numbers. That's what to me is very, very shocking. Were 37 million individuals, and I think they were all American, decided to join something like this. And the millions, that doesn't represent every cheating person. Now, a person who cheats might not necessarily do it online. They might do it with somebody at work, etc. And so I know that cheating has happened, and I like to believe that more people are faithful than cheaters. But if you look at the adult population, and this was just 37 million who had no problem doing it online, you just wonder the scope and the breadth of infidelity. And the younger generations look at marriage a little differently. They look at marriage as impractical. They say, I don't want to just sleep with one person my whole life. I don't want to just be with one person. That's what some people think. Others are like, all I want is one person. I don't need anybody else. I mean, that's how I feel with my husband. I really don't want to love. It's enough work. Loving one person. I'm sorry. Being married is enough work. I couldn't imagine balancing multiple relationships. It's too much. But for other people, they love the chase. They need to know that they're wanted. And we don't have open conversations about adultery because, one, it's a sin. Right? God doesn't want us doing it. It's one of the Ten Commandments. But maybe we could stave off some of the adultery having honest conversations about it. We just don't talk about cheating. We don't talk. I mean, we talk about it on my show. What are some of the reasons for it? What are some of the opportunities people take? Why they're taking it? And, you know, I'm, as a physician, I have seen my slew of families and couples who I thought were completely fine. And I was just shocked that there was this whole other dimension within that marriage that involved other people. Because people learn how to hide it well. Usually they don't hide it well enough because they end up getting caught. A friend of mine, who I was really not expecting this one, just got caught cheating. And it was, I almost wonder if it was so blatant that I almost wonder if they wanted to get caught. And it was their out of the marriage. And so, you know, the dynamic of it, you really need to, when somebody is, let's say, cheating, right, figure out what exactly is the reason. What is it? Is it that they're fearing growing old and they want to feel like they still have it? Is it because they never had their youth? They married their childhood sweetheart, or their childhood sweetheart got pregnant. So they, you know, felt like they did the right thing to marry, and they never loved that person. And so they never got to live what they think should be the life they should have lived. And now they want to have the passion. Now they want to have the love. Is it because they're bored? They're bored at work. They hate their job. And it makes it a whole lot more entertaining when you have a dalliance or a work romance. You know, what exactly is it that's going on? Is it that you can't stand your spouse? Is it that your spouse doesn't sleep with you and you're in a sexist marriage? I am not saying it's justified. None of those reasons are justified. If you're in a sexist marriage and you don't want to be, then you choose to end the marriage. You don't cheat on somebody. And by the way, if you said through thick and thin, till death do us part, in sickness and in health, whatever your vows were, and that person is not having sex with you because of medical reasons, you made a vow. It's your job to decide if you're going to live up to it or not, not cheat. There's no reason to do deceit. Is it because people are a part of a religion that it doesn't embrace divorce, where getting a divorce is so taboo that you feel it's less of a taboo to cheat? So you could technically tell God, but I didn't get a divorce. Is it that the divorce with whom you're with is going to be so financially chaotic that you don't want to go through the divorce? You'd rather try to get away with whatever you're doing. So there's a lot of different, I guess, dynamics at play, but this whole Ashley Madison thing, and I don't know if I'm going to watch the Netflix special. I'm actually in the middle of watching the Tom Brady roast, which is pretty funny, by the way. I mean, they say some bad things. I just am blown away at the numbers of people who cheat. And we maybe need to, before people get married, or, you know, but while these kids are, you know, learning all sorts of stuff in sex ed, but we don't really have conversations among children and adolescents about how our animalistic instinct is to, you know, want to be with individuals, and more, the default is multiple individuals. I mean, didn't Solomon have 100 wives? You know, in this day and age, we do monogamy, which I support, which is the right thing to do. I think it's safer. I think it's better for the family unit, but it's not practical for many. And if somebody identifies themselves as somebody who just can't be with one person and is feeling pressure to get married, that person might need to really rethink the whole marriage thing. This is why we now have all these families where we have baby mamas and different moms for different babies and different, because there are individuals out there that will cheat. And some women are like, look, I'd rather have the baby than not. If I can't tie this person down, I'd still rather start my family. And wow, it's amazing, you know, the strength they have to do that. I could not raise children alone. I need a partner. I needed my husband. But I think rather than us thinking the norm is people wanting to be monogamous, wanting to be faithful, wanting to live their life with one person till death do they us part, maybe the reality is the majority of people want to be around others. want to be with others. That's why the porn industry has just exploded. So we're not going to be able to prevent STDs, prevent the disasters of cheating and what it does to a marriage if we don't have honest conversations about what it is people want so they understand what they're committing to. 1-877-DOC-DOLLY. Dr. Daliah here. Are you tired, burned out, gaining weight, succumbing to the daily pressures of life? Well, how's your dopamine doing? How you feel right now, how you'll feel an hour from now, and how you'll feel next week is completely reliant on your dopamine. Our daily motivation and willingness to push through challenges depends on the intricate chemical process dopamine provides. Christian Kalikas and I created Deploying Dopamine, a book that tells you what dopamine is, when it dysfunctions, and how to successfully deploy it when needed. Find Deploying Dopamine on Amazon today. Check it out.
Carl Amari here to tell you about our newest website for old-time radio lovers. It's 100radioshows.com. At this site, there are 5 old-time radio shows waiting for you to download free as our gift to you. And be sure to browse the additional 700 old-time radio shows available to you for 70% off by using the promo code radio at checkout. This is a limited-time offer, so log on to 100radioshows.com. That's 100radioshows.com.
All right, we are back on the Dr. Daliah Show, 1-877-DOC-DALI, 1-877-DOCDALI. Don't forget to follow us on Twitter or X at Dr. Daliah and on Facebook, the Dr. Daliah Show. So after the whole $20 an hour minimum wage hike for fast food, no doubt and not a surprise, there has been more calls for even higher wages. In fact, I keep seeing headlines saying in California, they want to maybe raise the minimum wage to $30 an hour, or some groups are advocating for that. So a $30 an hour minimum wage is a topic that, you know, you would think won't go far, but no, it is. In fact, I think there are some counties that have already decided to increase minimum wage to $28. Let me just double check this here. They say Long Beach, according to Savvy Dime, has taken a step by approving a measure to increase hotel workers' wages to $23 an hour and raise it to $29.50 by 2028, which is 4 years from now. And so this momentum, this is just Long Beach alone, the momentum to raise minimum wage, I think Los Angeles, already they're going to have airport workers at $30 an hour. It means we need to have a conversation about what exactly are minimum wage jobs and what minimum wage is. And it's, I think it's panicking people. I think it's also causing a lot of job loss. And the way we did fast food and minimum wage jobs in the 60s and 70s and 80s and 90s is probably not realistic now. And so if we're trying to fit these higher wages into a generation or multi-generation old structure, it's not going to work. Nobody is going to want to pay a high school student $30 an hour to flip burgers. But high school students are not necessarily the ones working in fast food. Now you have individuals. After the Great Recession in the teens, we had more and more adults, family, heads of the family, need to go to fast food to feed their family. So this idea of, well, these minimum wage jobs, these fast food jobs shouldn't be at $30 an hour. Maybe we're thinking wrong because the whole, I guess, structure of that used to be, I mean, I made $4.15 an hour when I worked at Jack in the Box. I didn't have a car, so I could at least walk to my apartment or to my dorm or wherever I lived. There was a Jack in the Box on Maryland Parkway in Tropicana, and I used to work there near UNLV. And I would, you know, flip burgers, cashier, do whatever I had to do, made my $4 an hour. When I waited tables, I made, I think, two something an hour, but I made more tips, but I couldn't wait tables till I was 21. And so these jobs were sustainable. I mean, I could, you know, get by with roommates, with no car, et cetera, but there was no way I could live long term on $4 an hour. There's no way people right now could live long term on $7.25 an hour. Things have changed. The problem is minimum wage jobs was how fast food could be cheap. The whole sort of mechanism of selling dollar burgers, or this McDonald's $5 meal plan that's going to be for a limited time, where I think you get a burger and fries and drink and four McNuggets for $5. The only reason why that was able to work, or dollar menus or $2 menus or whatever, is because they don't have to pay $100,000 a year salaries. They don't have to, have sick leave and maternity and that. You know, they're hiring part-time teenagers. And so the food could be cheaper. I think there were, 25-cent ice cream cones in the 90s. Why? Because they're only paying that person $4 or $5 to make that ice cream cone. And they figured they'll sell enough to be able to pay the salary of those employees. Now that we are moving to no, fast food has to be in California at least at $20 an hour. And now there's this big push, 20 is not enough, it needs to be 30. Maybe what we need to do is rethink and restructure things. Because I think everybody understands now that $7.25 can't get you far. But we're also seeing that the prices for things is ridiculous. Trying to go out to dinner with my family, it's so ridiculously expensive that it just doesn't make sense. And when I go, so I cooked dinner last night. I made some chicken. It was teriyaki lime chicken. It actually was really, really good. Made some chicken, had a veggie tray, no carbs. So they had a fairly healthy, you know, although there's a little sugar in that teriyaki. But still, to buy the chicken and to buy the vegetables, we were almost at the price of going out to eat. That, you know, things are getting more expensive. And so, I think the idea of a minimum wage job as we see it for young kids to start getting their feet wet in the economy and learning how to hold a job and deal with the uniform and show up to work on time, that's no more. People in fast food are now customer service representatives. They're now cooks or chefs. They are now management. So when we think minimum wage, we think gas station, car wash, McDonald's. No, now that these companies have to pay more, and as well as benefits, as well as maternity leave, these are actual, you know, non-minimum wage jobs, but jobs. These are, and so if a fast food restaurant is going to have management, they're going to have suits. It's going to have customer service representatives, communication experts, going to have sanitation departments. Then, yeah, you're not going to be getting 99-cent burgers anymore. McDonald's is called a restaurant. These are now restaurants. These are, the whole thing is changing. And a $30 an hour salary for an individual that works there will only be sustainable if they are charging high prices, which means to me, we're probably starting to look at the end of fast food. There is no way you could have a $4.99 Whopper if you're paying $30 an hour, even $20 an hour. And we're going to have more automation. They can't make these machines fast enough that'll do the burgers on their own. I see in some areas you could buy pizza in a machine. They're ready-made pizzas, hot. These companies are going to evolve to figure out how to not pay that much in terms for their employees, which means fast food will be vending machine. And if you want to walk into a McDonald's or Jack in the Box or Chick-fil-A, it's going to have to be then a restaurant experience or something that allows them to charge more. And so I think we have to maybe start getting it out of our head that teenagers are not who's working at these places. And then what do we do? What if there's not enough of these jobs? We have a lot of migrants coming in and they want to work. They want to work, especially the ethical ones, not the ones, you know, who are sneaking over the border and doing drugs and working for cartel. And so do we have enough of these jobs? If I owned a franchise and I had to pay $30 an hour to somebody, a franchise would close. Can't do it. You know, why do you think we have this tip issue with this whole tipping culture? It's because these employers are trying to tell employees, look, you're going to average $40 an hour because of your tips. So don't look at it as only a $15 an hour job. You're going to make more because of tips. That's why we're being forced to tip. So we're going to have to just change our whole thinking. But at this point, this isn't sustainable, especially a $30 an hour minimum wage. 1-877-DOCDELLY.
Considered by most, optimized curcumin is one of the few bioavailable and highly absorbable curcumin products on the market. Hi, I'm Dr. Mitch. Since most chronic diseases have inflammation, our optimized curcumin seems to be a perfect addition to any nutritional program. It makes sense to me that preventing or reducing inflammation is a key component to our overall health. The Mayo Clinic found that curcumin can decrease swelling and inflammation, has antioxidant properties, and research suggests that curcumin can prevent cancer, or at least slow the spread of cancer, and in many instances make chemotherapy more effective. It protects our healthy cells even from radiation. TotalWellness.com, where we help you to look good, feel good, and enjoy total wellness.
Self-reliance. It's not a phrase we hear much in our culture these days. It might conjure up images of pioneers, the West, rifles, strapping men, and strong women. But what does it mean for us in today's world? The New American Magazine has just released its latest collector's edition, Self-Reliance, Foundation of Freedom. In it, the New American authors outline the necessity of self-reliance for a free people, tips for self-reliant living, and the importance of not giving up hope. This unique edition includes articles on the self-sufficiency of the founders, preparing for a worst-case scenario, firearms, financial self-reliance, the importance of community, and many other topics by expert writers. Now, for a limited time, the New American is offering a bundle of three collector's editions, Self-Reliance, The Great Reset, and Trump World, for just $19.95. Available at shopjbs.org. Visit shopjbs.org today.
We are back on the Dr. Daliah Show. Thank you all for tuning in. 1-877-DOCDALI, 1-877-DOCDALI. So one thing that I did in my practice, and my husband does, are CDL physicals, or these DOT physicals, these commercial driving license physicals. And what is always fascinating to me are the numbers of people trying to cheat, especially when they have to have a drug test. Not all physicals need a drug test, but many workplaces want drug testing done. And the industry that allows you to cheat on drug tests is booming. In fact, the Wall Street Journal is reporting that more workers are cheating on drug tests than ever before. It is the highest rate in more than 30 years. They say the increase in tampered drug tests came from samples collected in 2023. And the Quest Diagnostics has found a rising number of marijuana positive tests. And Americans are going through great lengths to attempt to subvert the drug testing process, according to Dr. Suhash Harawani, Senior Director for Science for Workforce Health Conditions at Quest. So workforce positive drug screens were particularly high last year for jobs associated with office work, according to Quest. They said marijuana positivity was up last year in 13 out of 15 industries. Finance, insurance, public administration, positive tests rose by 24%. Real estate, rental, leasing jobs, 22%. Positive marijuana screens were higher in the education sector, as well as professional, scientific, and technical services. See, you can't have any marijuana if you drive. Right now, marijuana is still Schedule 1 illegal. So if you use marijuana, you can't drive commercially. So it's for people who want to keep their job or want, and these employers have liability issues. And so they need to know that their staff, especially if, you know, they could hurt other people or, you know, be in charge machinery, et cetera. You know, they, for their liability, they need to show that they tested you. What's also happening is these workers' comp injuries. Many workers' comp insurance companies will not pay and cover the employee's injury if they were under the influence of drugs or had drugs in their system. So some of these cases could be there was a workers' comp injury. So when they went to get addressed and then did the test, they were positive. They said the percentage of urine samples that came back positive for drugs among the U.S. workforce remained steady at a two-decade high for the third year in a row. But the rise of tampering has now spiked. And according to Kate Mueller, a senior program director focusing on cannabis safety at the National Safety Council, said this is disturbing. So how are people cheating on the tests? Well, one is they could be drinking a lot of water, which, again, you could put yourself into hyponatremia. But what they do is they try to dilute their urine. And they're trying to dilute their urine so much that it hopefully doesn't get picked up. I'm telling you right now, you can't drink enough to do that. These tests are pretty sensitive. And so if they pick up a fraction, you know, and it's a qualitative test instead of quantitative. Qualitative is yes or no. Is it present or not? Quantitative is, well, how much? If it's a qualitative test, it doesn't matter how much you dilute. They said another is using somebody else's urine. My husband had a patient come in, looked like they were carrying something or had a bladder attached to them. And then when you do a urine drug test, the temperature is checked as well. If your urine is ambient temperature, your urine is supposed to be roughly 98.6, your body temperature. That's warm. So if your urine is room temperature, it's fake. See? So they've seen that. They said 6,000 urine samples out of 5.5 million collected from the general U.S. workforce were classified as substituted. Now, those are the ones that got caught. It's interesting. My son had to do a drug test at work, and he passed with flying colors. It was just a routine drug test. But his drug test, the officer or the military, because he works for the Air Force, one of the officers had to watch him. So he's standing there going, "Do we talk? What do we do? What do we talk about?" I mean, he's a hand just, yeah, and he's, and the guy's like, "We don't have to talk. We don't have to connect. We don't have to make eye contact. Just pee. Do what you have to do." I remember for the hospital in our training, we had to do drug tests before we did residency. That, we went into the bathroom by ourselves. Nobody watched us pee, but there was no sink and there was no water in the toilet. So you couldn't adulterate the sample. So, I mean, some of them are really simple where you go in by yourself. Others, they are watching every single move you make. There's also additives that some people are using. They said 25,000 drug tests were classified as invalid, meaning somebody mixed the urine sample with an additive. These additives are sold online. A lot of them are fake, people. They claim they hide marijuana. They could be fake. And so you're taking something that is not FDA approved, that could be some random chemical. You need to be careful. Quest classifies substitute or invalid urine samples as a failed drug test. And so when they give the results, they might say adulterated, or it might say, you know, positive for this, positive for that. But so I had a kidney stone, and so I was drinking a lot of water. And so one of the drug tests I had to do for the hospital, which was routine, seemed to be dilute. And I had no drugs, so it was, but they said, your urine is dilute. I go, yeah, I have to drink multiple gallons a day because of my kidney stone. I could redo it, but I passed a kidney stone last year, so I have to drink lots of water, and I redid it. There was no drugs, but they'll make you redo it. And they might say either you failed, which could hurt your job chances, or they might say it needs to be retested. But, you know, marijuana has become very, very popular. I know it's popular in my neck of the woods once it was legalized. And I think a lot of people don't understand that just because it's a legal substance in your state doesn't mean you can have it in your system at work. Some of these drug tests pick up alcohol. You can't go to work drunk. You can't still have alcohol in your system from the night before and go in at 5 a.m. So you have to understand that if you're going to use these, there's a time difference. So marijuana could be in your system for weeks. It could be in your hair for at least a month. So depending on them doing a blood test or a urine test, you know, marijuana could be in your system for days. It also depends on how much you took. And now that we're using more potent strains, it could be in there longer. And we talked about in the past what drug stays in your system the longest, whether it's meth or coke or whatever. But honestly, if you're using, you're going to eventually get caught. And if you're working for a job that doesn't want you to do drugs, you have to make a decision and you have to stop the drugs. And I understand people are using marijuana to sleep. They're using marijuana to not eat. They're using marijuana to improve their appetite. They're using marijuana just to have fun. Who knows? But you trying to pass a drug test by cheating looks worse. So, you know, employers also have to decide what is the best thing for them from a liability standpoint. So if you are driving for their company and you get into an accident and they're liable, they're going to have very little wiggle room. They would rather have fewer drivers than someone who uses drugs. So just be aware. 1-877-DOC-DOLLY. Don't go away.
Did you know that healthy arteries make a gas? Yes, actually three known gases. Hi, I'm Dr. Mitch, and nitric oxide is a gas that's readily made all day long to keep our arteries open by relaxing the blood vessel walls. By doing this, our circulation is increased, bringing blood, oxygen, and nutrients to every part of your body. Both age and poor diet can lead to a loss of this precious gas, and in turn, blood pressure can go up, energy can go down, and you can get tingling in your hands and feet. Well, our product, Ultimate Nitric Oxide, can easily help fix this lack of nitric oxide. Go to TotalWellness.com. That's TotalWellness.com, where we are helping you to look good, feel good, and enjoy Total Wellness.